Good afternoon, everybody. I'm District Judge Michael Liburdi. I'm introducing this next panel session. Congress established the Federal Trade Commission over a century ago to protect the public from unfair and deceptive trade practices. This includes protecting consumers from the excessive accumulation of market power. The FTC enjoys broad regulatory and enforcement authority, and this is shared with the Department of Justice. We are honored to have with us today Lina Khan, Chair of the Federal Trade Commission. Prior to joining the FTC in 2021, Chair Khan served as counsel for the United States House Judiciary Committee's Subcommittee on Antitrust, Commercial, and Administrative Law. She was also an associate professor at Columbia Law School. Chair Khan is a graduate of the Yale Law School, and her influential work, Amazon's Antitrust Paradox, was published in the Yale Law Journal. Under Chair Khan's leadership, the FTC has refocused its mission, and it has taken additional steps to fulfill its statutory objectives. It is my pleasure to introduce Chair Khan to the Ninth Circuit Judicial Conference. And with her is United States District Judge Yvonne Gonzalez-Rogers. Judge Gonzalez-Rogers is a judge of the Northern District of California. She is a graduate of the University of Texas Law School. Prior to her appointment by President Obama, she was an equity partner at one of San Francisco's largest law firms, and she was a Superior Court judge. Judge Gonzalez-Rogers sits on many judicial and law-related committees, and noteworthy is her role as the judicial representative to the American Bar Association's antitrust law section. So welcome, Judge Gonzalez-Rogers.
Thank you so much, Judge Liburdi. Chair Khan, it is such a pleasure to have you with us. I have to tell you, I don't know how many people have come up to me and said, we are so excited about getting to hear from you. So thank you for making the trip from DC. I know you've been all over the country this week, and we really appreciate you adding us to your schedule. So I'd like to start with just an arc. I mean, that is, let's start at the beginning. I want to close at the end, looking at the future. And then in the middle of the conversation, we can talk about various components of antitrust litigation. But starting at the beginning, you know, you came into the FTC, I think, with big ideas. You're a big personality, obviously a superstar. You know, you're relative, I think, right, the youngest FTC chair ever. So what is it that you really wanted to accomplish? And let me just remind you, in case you don't know, you've got Ninth Circuit judges, district judges, bankruptcy judges, litigators, and people who know nothing about antitrust. So just practitioners who are here. So give us just an overview of really what it is you wanted to achieve coming into this role.
Well, first of all, it's such an honor to be here, and I really appreciate the invitation. So I got my introduction and start in antitrust in a bit of a quirky way. I was always really interested in journalism and business reporting, graduated during the financial crisis where journalism jobs were far and few between, and so ended up at a policy institute and think tank, where my job was to really document market structures across sectors. And so I was assigned with, you know, understanding how the chicken farming industry worked, for example, or the rental car industry or book publishing. And so got a real tour of all sorts of sectors across our economy and saw how over decades markets in all these different areas had become much more consolidated. And through talking to market participants, started to see what the real life effects of that consolidation had been. And so in chicken farming, for example, we've seen not just horizontal consolidation, where now there are four major chicken processing companies that are dominant, but also vertical integration. And the result of that has been that, you know, chicken farmers generally find themselves in a much more precarious situation. They're regionally, oftentimes, their livelihood is dependent on just one company. And so, you know, a decade ago, the government started to look into this and started holding listening sessions, inviting these farmers to come talk to them. And as I was interviewing them, I realized that many of them were afraid to show up and afraid to speak up. And it was a really vivid illustration to me about how threats to core liberties, like even the ability to speak up or share information with the government, can actually be threatened not just by coercive state power, but also by coercive private power, which I think goes back to just the original spirits of the antitrust laws and the anti-monopoly laws, where there was a real recognition of, if we want Americans to be able to really enjoy freedom and liberty, we need to secure safeguards against concentrated power, not only in our sphere of governance, but also in our commercial sphere. And so broadly, you know, the FTC was created against the backdrop, and those are the values of economic freedom and liberty that really animate a lot of what antitrust is about. Since I've had the honor of joining the commission, our work has really been animated by, you know, fidelity to the law, fidelity to market realities, and fidelity to really serving the public. You know, I'll just go briefly through each one of those on fidelity to the law. You know, antitrust is a really fascinating area of law. It's also an area of law where, in recent decades, some of the ordinary tools of statutory interpretation and methods that we use to understand what does this law mean don't get applied. And so part of what we've been doing is going back to the text of the statutes, looking at the three principal antitrust statutes, the Sherman Act, the Clayton Act, the FTC Act, and trying to understand what was Congress looking to do here. In instances where these laws say different things, we need to honor that rather than just collapsing them onto one. And so we've really been focused on a project to fully honor what Congress was seeking to do with each of these statutes.
And can I interrupt? And just, because yeah. That's what I do in oral argument all the time, just interrupt. You say fidelity to the law. You know, I was not an econ major, did not come to this, I mean, with a background in antitrust law. And a lot of what I've read over the years is that plaintiffs, government agencies are frustrated with the state of antitrust law. That it is not conducive to really challenging in an effective way monopolies, anti-competitive conduct. But, you know, we as district judges, we have to follow the law in our circuit across the country. So when you say fidelity to the law, does that mean that you're challenging circuit interpretations and going back to the text, or what do you really mean by that?
So one thing I mean by that is actually looking at all of the statutes. I think oftentimes, you know, when we think of antitrust, we think of the Sherman Act, which is, you know, a pillar of antitrust, but we also have the Clayton Act and the FTC Act, each of which was passed in order to fix what Congress actually saw as some deficiencies in the Sherman Act. And so the Clayton Act was passed because Congress worried that addressing monopolization once it was fully baked was too late. And so the Clayton Act has much more of a prophylactic orientation. We're charged with, you know, stopping anti-competitive practices in their incipiency. The FTC Act was actually created in the wake of the Standard Oil decision, which came down in 1911, and most people remember that decision for breaking up Standard Oil. But in antitrust jurisprudence, the decision was really important because it introduced this concept of reasonable versus unreasonable restraints of trade. And Congress actually received this decision very negatively. I mean, the day after the Standard Oil decision came out, there was an enormous amount of agitation. Lawmakers basically saw the Standard Oil decision as a power grab by the courts and really worried that this would, you know, allow basically judges to decide what was reasonable and unreasonable in ways that would unmoor legal development from what Congress had intended. And so the FTC Act was passed as a way to create an expert agency to, you know, be charged with preventing unfair methods of competition. those words are very different from the words in the Sherman Act and in the Clayton Act. And Congress was clear with that there was supposed to be some greater flexibility with what unfair methods of competition was able to touch. The trade-off would be that the remedial scheme was more limited. So there are no private rights of action under the FTC Act. Even our ability to get money is quite limited. And so, you know, part of what we've been doing is going back and saying, okay, let's honor what Section 5 of the FTC Act means. It says something different than what the Sherman Act says. And so an effort to just collapse the FTC Act into the Sherman Act seems unwise and contrary to what this law is supposed to be about. And so one of our first projects was to issue a policy statement really canvassing a century of what unfair methods of competition jurisprudence says, put it out there, and we've started to activate that provision and bring cases under that where we can reach practices that we might not otherwise be able to reach under the Sherman Act.
And in terms of that, I mean, well, we can talk about Chevron later and how that's going to impact that approach. If you could look at the circuits, and we're sitting in the Ninth, where does the Ninth sit compared to others in terms of how they're reacting to this kind of new approach?
So we have a whole set of cases underway across the country. Some of our merger cases have been brought in the Ninth Circuit. Some have been brought in the Fifth Circuit and the Second Circuit. We actually got a really big win a few months ago in the Fifth Circuit, where one of our challenges to a vertical merger, so this is when you have a combination between companies in different parts of the supply chain, we won, which was the first time the government had succeeded in blocking a vertical merger in around 50 years. In the Ninth Circuit, we currently have one of our merger challenges up on appeal, so we're waiting to see how that shakes out. We also recently issued new merger guidelines, which are designed to reflect not just fidelity to law, but also this idea of fidelity to market realities. Markets have changed an enormous amount, even in the last decade. And so we want to be sure that when we're thinking about, you know, is a deal, say, substantially lessening competition, we have a ground level understanding of how companies are even competing in a particular marketplace, right? Sometimes companies are competing on price, sometimes they're competing on quality. Sometimes competition is happening in a way between direct head-to-head rivals, but sometimes it's happening not between direct replicas, but between companies in adjacent markets. And this is especially true in digital markets, where oftentimes the threat to an incumbent is coming not from a direct replica, but from a market in a slightly different area where the risk is of disintermediation. And so to take the classic Microsoft example, Microsoft was afraid of Netscape not because it was an operating system, but because it threatened to introduce a layer that would basically commoditize operating systems. And so making sure we have a ground level understanding of how is competition manifesting in a particular market and how do we make sure our analysis reflects that is another key goal.
So I had a couple of questions coming out of that, but let's start with the merger issue. The FTC has lost a lot of merger challenges that have actually gone to court. It seems as if a number of investigations have led to people just saying, okay, we're not going to go through it with it in the first instance. But why do you think it is that there have been so many losses in terms of challenges on the merger front?
So we've overall had around 40 deals that have been abandoned in light of FTC action. Some of those have been after we filed a complaint. Some of those have been after we fully won a preliminary injunction. In addition to the Fifth Circuit win, we also won recently in the Southern District of New York in a deal relating to healthcare advertisers where there was both a vertical component as well as a horizontal component. There are two merger cases that we have lost out of those 40 overall, both in the Ninth Circuit. One involved basically a theory around nascent competition. So this idea that even when you have a market that is pretty dynamic, that is in flux, you can still have a dominant player that is buying out what it sees as a perceived potential competitor or an actual potential competitor. The defense in that case was basically that this doctrine doesn't apply in these types of digital markets. And we, you know, resoundingly won on the idea that potential competition is alive and well, even in these digital markets. There was also some really helpful analysis about how you do this work in these markets. And so we lost on the facts, not on the law. We also have our Microsoft Activision challenge, which is up on appeal right now. So we'll see how that goes. But overall, I think there is a broader recognition and a vindication of the approach that the FTC and DOJ are taking. One of the other cases we filed last year involved this idea of serial acquisitions. So when you have a company that is engaging in a roll-up of a market through a whole series of transactions, no one of which alone may trigger antitrust scrutiny, but in the aggregate, a market may still have been rolled up. So we brought a case involving a roll-up of anesthesiology providers in Texas, and we just got a favorable decision on that in Texas as well. So, you know, it's I think too early to ultimately say if the strategy is, you know, overall successful or where some of the weak points are, but we are already seeing some programmatic advances.
Well, do we need to start thinking about economics differently in this, you know, in this context of digital platforms, one-sided platforms, two-sided platforms, the entire digital economy? Do our traditional economic models that we've been looking at over years, do they still apply? We as judges, you know, there are many people who are, you know, had economic backgrounds, but many of us didn't have economic backgrounds. So what do? We look at the cases, we look at the law, we try to listen to the experts. But do we have to fundamentally think about competition differently in this new economy?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And, you know, economics provides a really important set of analytical tools for us to figure out, are these firms competing? How are they competing? You know, do you see win-loss data that is showing, you know, the firms are actually going head-to-head? But it's true that in some of these digital markets in particular, you know, people are paying with their data rather than through dollars. And so how you assess, you know, price competition on those types of privacy competition on those types of dimensions becomes an interesting question. One thing that we've been doing at the FTC is broadening the set of methodological tools and skill sets that we have in-house to be able to do this analysis. And so in addition to, you know, around 100 PhD IO economists, we've also been bringing on, you know, labor economists, macroeconomists, financial accountants, people who are able to, you know, do analysis in ways that might be able to fill in some of the blind spots. Last year, we also launched a new Office of Technology, and so we've been bringing on technologists, data scientists, data engineers, people who are embedding across our investigative teams to make sure we can fully understand, you know, how are these algorithms working, what's really going on here, to make sure we can better do this analysis too. I think the other thing that's interesting in areas of antitrust doctrine is that there is an embedded descriptive account of how markets work sometimes. And when that descriptive account of how markets work becomes outdated, that's when you can start to see a gap between the doctrine and the market realities. So just to give a concrete example, there were a set of Supreme Court decisions in the late 80s that basically said predatory pricing as a business practice is extremely rare and mostly irrational. And so in light of that, the court created a pretty high standard for plaintiffs to be able to meet. The result has been that predatory pricing cases have collapsed. And the thinking was that, you know, most businesses are profit maximizers, and so to undertake a strategy where you would actually be losing money on the prospect that you might be able to raise your competitors and then later inflate the price, even though the inflation of the price would then trigger rivals to come in, that overall that was a very risky strategy and likely to ever pan out. Fast forward, you know, 40 years, and what we see in digital markets is a very different set of dynamics, right? These are markets that really privilege early movers and early winners, given the way that network externalities and the feedback loops from data really allow some of these early movers to lock in a competitive advantage. And so for digital firms in particular, the business incentive early is to build and expand scale and build and expand your user base as quickly as possible. And so in those types of instances in particular, it can actually be extraordinarily rational and reasonable to start off by underpricing or by even giving away things for free, because the way you're going to recoup that value is by being able to monetize the user base later. And so, you know, that's just one example of where the law and the doctrine says this business strategy is irrational, but now we actually see the exact opposite. And so I think that's where we run into some of these challenges.
The other challenge that we have been talking about over the last course of the last couple of days is artificial intelligence. And I'm interested to hear your view on this intersection between AI, antitrust law, competition law. You know, it used to be right that at the gas stations across the street, they'd put the little, you know, they'd signal what their prices were going to be and people could see, but there was no explicit kind of collusion, but people knew it was going on. And here we're getting to a point where AI is collecting a lot of information. And you've got programs that are, you know, presumably generic, but if everybody's using the same program, how is that work into your analysis, and how should we as judges think about that?
It's a really fascinating area and something we're following quite closely. You're absolutely right that on the antitrust side, there are a whole set of implications. As you alluded to, there are some cases now alleging that competitors within a market have all been using the same pricing algorithm, and that this pricing algorithm could in effect be facilitating a form of price fixing or collusion. And so even though you don't have, you know, a handshake in a back room somewhere, these algorithms are still functionally enabling that illegal agreement. And so, you know, there are cases right now percolating around that. I think how that ends up shaking out is going to be extraordinarily critical. I think what we all want to avoid is some type of AI exemption to the antitrust laws, where if you collude through a handshake, it's illegal, but if you collude through algorithm, it's fine. And so I think, you know, there's some really important issues being teed up around this. More generally, it's a really interesting moment because historically, these moments of technological disruption and inflection points have historically been ones that have posed a threat to the incumbents. But what we see with AI is that a lot of the raw material is actually currently owned by some of the existing incumbents. And so there's a core question to be asked around whether some of these bottlenecks and choke points that we're already seeing, be it at the chips layer, be it at the cloud layer, whether those could be exploited in ways that will cut off the opportunity and innovation that these types of technological moments are supposed to represent. So we're scrutinizing those bottlenecks. We have an inquiry ongoing looking at some of the investments and partnerships that we're seeing between some of the incumbents and the startups, wanting to make sure that those are not being used to co-opt this moment and shield the incumbents from competition. The FTC is also an enforcer of the consumer protection laws, which is where we're seeing some of the most immediate impact of AI tools. And so we're seeing a surge in fraud in particular, because these AI tools are basically enabling fraudsters to disseminate fraud much more quickly, much more cheaply, and on a much wider scale. We're also tracking very closely this issue of voice cloning fraud, where people will basically, you know, pretend to, you know, call somebody up, pretend to be your grandkid, ask for money.
But you're not going after those individually, are you? Or are you sending that information to the FBI and then it's getting prosecuted in the individual districts, or are you?
So we have some cases already that have gone after the use of AI to impersonate the government or impersonate a legitimate business. And so in those instances, we have been able to go after particular players. I think generally one really interesting policy question in AI is gonna be, what does the liability scheme here look like? And is it just the downstream actors that are misusing the technology that carry the liability, or is there some responsibility with the upstream players? We have some experience with this in the context of robocalls, for example, where if you just look at the downstream players, you can very quickly end up playing whack-a-mole, where you have one fly-by-night scammer and you have another one. One strategy that we've deployed over the last couple of years is actually looking upstream at the companies that are facilitating and enabling the illegal robocalls. And so we've been going after these VoIP providers and other upstream platforms as a more efficient way to go after it. So I think what that looks like in the AI context is still an open question.
I have two pages of questions, okay. But if I get questions, I'm just going to interrupt, and we'll take the audience's questions. The first one says, how do you see Corner Post and other Supreme Court cases from this term on administrative law impacting your plans for the FTC and its activities and regulation in the future?
So we're following all of that quite closely. I think Corner Post could be quite destabilizing across the federal government. For the FTC, a lot of our rules are actually promulgated not pursuant to the APA, but pursuant to the Magnuson-Moss regime, which actually in statute lays out just 60 days for those rules and regulations to be challenged, so there might be some more insulation there. As a general matter, the FTC has not relied as much on Chevron deference as much as agencies like the FCC or the EPA, so I think the immediate impact may be more limited, especially since most of our rules are promulgated pursuant to a different statutory scheme outside of APA. But look, there's no question that if you have a court that is, increasingly second-guessing agency interpretation of agency statutes, I think all agencies are on clear notice about that and following those developments very closely. We issued a few months ago a final rule banning non-compete clauses. That has been challenged, and we have some challenges percolating. We got an adverse decision on the PI at the PI phase in Texas a few weeks ago, and just got yesterday a very favorable decision in the Eastern District of Pennsylvania. Chevron actually has not been a key threshold issue in either of those. It's more around the core statutory authority. Do we have it? Yes, no. So that could end up, depending on how some of these other challenges shake out, be a key vehicle for some of these questions too.
Second question. Arguably, there is no bigger monopoly holder than the government. Should the FTC be doing more to go after anti-competitive licensing boards, especially after the Supreme Court's decision in NC Dental versus FTCP?
Yeah, it's a good question, and the FTC has historically scrutinized some of these licensing boards, and we continue as we get complaints to look into that as appropriate. We have generally been also scrutinizing instances where we think there is monopoly abuse or just business abuse of government process. And so over the last few months, we've really been scrutinizing what is known as Orange Book fraud. So the Orange Book is a repository of patent listings that is overseen by the FDA. We had a team take a close look and identify some patent listings that we thought were illegitimate and potentially resulting in, inhaler prices being much higher than they should, given that these have been on the market for 5 decades. But people are still sometimes paying hundreds of dollars, and generic entry in inhalers has actually been more limited. And so we have been sending out letters contesting what we see as potentially illegitimate patent listings in the Orange Book, and really also urging the FDA to play more of a leading role in scrutinizing this. So we are looking at where do we think that government processes could be abused and exploited by some of these actors.
Yesterday, when we met at a reception, I mentioned that I wanted to talk about experts. And your response was, don't get me started. So let's get you started. Experts are obviously a critical part of any antitrust or competition case. It is frustrating for many district judges that we always get Daubert motions, because frequently it's the multiple PhD from MIT, Harvard versus the Princeton, Stanford. I mean, all of these folks have incredible, impeccable credentials. You know, it's not as if they aren't qualified. Now, sometimes perhaps they go too far, and that would be an appropriate reason to bring a motion. But we get them all the time, and it's typically, you know, when you cut to the chase, they just don't agree with the opinion of the expert. In England, and I'm curious to see what you think about this. In England, experts have a special duty, an overriding duty to the court. There is a rule, 35.3, that says it is the duty of experts to help the court on matters within their expertise. Sub 2, this duty overrides any obligation to the person from whom experts have received instructions or by whom they are paid. What do you think if we had a rule that said experts have an overriding duty to the court as opposed to the person who hired them?
I think it could probably create much better incentives than what we have today. I mean, right now you basically have a system where there's an arms race between each side to kind of load up on the experts and really end up spending an enormous amount of money. I mean, for the FTC, you know, on a merger case, we can spend up to $3 or $4 or $5 million on an expert. On a conduct case like monopolization, these cases can cost as much as $20 million just on the expert costs alone, which is around 5% of our annual budget. So this is a serious cost to taxpayers. You might think, okay, well, if the expert analysis is actually aiding the court's decision making, then maybe it's worth it. But I think what's been especially frustrating is to see some opinions come out where the court has basically determined that the experts canceled each other out. You know, this is extraordinarily technical analysis. Sometimes the judge will say, well, you know, you both sound really smart. You both have your fancy models and you basically come out even. And so let me look at some of the more traditional factors of how you decide these cases. And so I think in those instances in particular, it can be extraordinarily frustrating that we're spending, you know, millions of dollars in taxpayer resources to get this expert analysis because we're in this arms race with the other side, and if we don't invest, we will be handicapped. But it doesn't always seem to be actually aiding the court's analysis based on what we're hearing from the judges. And so I think that's where the frustration is.
Well, I mean, so do you have a view about how these cases get litigated? I mean, first of all, at least with some of them, it seems that they take an incredibly long time. Many of them take an incredibly long time to litigate, which just increases the cost, generally, in my opinion. The more time you give lawyers to litigate, the more they spend, as opposed to focusing. Should judges have early evidentiary hearings where you try to figure out what are the kind of core pivotal issues, where let's focus the experts on those things and perhaps get interim rulings. Would that help settle these cases? Maybe not. I don't know. I mean, have you all thought internally? I mean, I know you didn't grow up a litigator, but have you talked internally about, you know, perhaps trying other measures in front of judges to, you know, reduce the cost or at least focus what the issue is in front of the court to just streamline the process?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. And actually, in one of our big monopolization cases, which is pretty early in its in where it's at, we actually got a invitation from the judge to have what he's calling Economist Day. Where we're kind of going to come together and talk about some of the key economic issues before they set off on writing their expert report. So I think, you know, there's some interesting levers here. But I think more generally, you know, right now the cost of experts is actually serving as a real impediment to enforcement at the federal level, but also at the state level. I mean, the state AGs have historically played an incredibly important role when it comes to antitrust enforcement. And routinely, we hear from our state partners that you know, they're seeing a lot of challenges, they're seeing a lot of issues in particular markets, but they're not able to bring cases because the expert costs are so prohibitive.
Well, now they're happier, right? Because now they can bring suits in their own states
and they can't be transferred out. So
yeah, that's right.
That may help. More questions. So many market forces that affect consumers are very local. For example, mergers between most of the anesthesiologist practices in Boise. What is the FTC doing in these very local markets?
It's a good question, and a lot of the markets that the FTC does oversee has some of these local implications. The best example probably being our hospital merger work. So the FTC has been extraordinarily active in blocking what we view as illegal hospital deals, which, you know, there's been a ton of hospital consolidation over the last few decades. There's an enormous amount of empirical work showing that more often than not, hospital mergers have led to higher prices, to lower quality. When hospitals get shut down, it can also create, you know, access to healthcare challenges, especially in rural areas. And so there's, you know, particular analysis we do to try to gauge what is the local competition. Oftentimes the arguments we hear is, no, this isn't such a local market, but we're actually competing with this hospital 50 miles away, 60 miles away. And so it all just ends up being extraordinarily fact specific. One issue that also can end up playing out in some of these local markets is that deals may be below the reporting threshold. So the Hart-Scott-Rodino Act requires deals to be reported if they're these days somewhere around over $119 million. But some of these local markets have deals that are below that, and so we don't have visibility. We've been, through some of our consent decrees, requiring especially some of the repeat players to actually provide more notice to the agency, even for some of these sub-HSR deals, which we hope will give us more visibility into some of the local markets.
Well, and how are you deciding that? So why don't you explain, you have regional offices. Explain the decision-making structure and into when it is you choose to go forward at a, you know, in a particular case. Do you have recommendations from staff? How does that work?
So practically, on the merger enforcement front, this is an area where we have to be extraordinarily reactive. The deals coming through the door are the ones that we are charged with investigating. We share jurisdiction with the Justice Department's antitrust division, and so we divide and conquer with them based on, you know, traditional areas of expertise. There are some statutory limits to the FTC's jurisdiction, so banks and common carriers like railroads and airlines go to DOJ. And then the team investigates, and the way that the Hart-Scott-Rodino Act scheme is set out, we usually have only 30 days on the front end to determine whether we're going to send out what's known as a second request, which is then what initiates the full investigation. If that ends up going out, then sometimes we enter into a timing agreement with the parties that determine how long we have to investigate. Sometimes the parties don't enter into a timing agreement, in which case we have as much time as basically they allow based on when they submit their information and certify. And so the team, gets to work, looks through at the documents, does a lot of interviews with market participants and third parties. Our economists look through a lot of the data that's submitted, and ultimately the team makes a recommendation. Ultimately, it's the commission that decides whether to move forward. We do that based not just on the strength of the case, but also, what are the competing areas? What would this potentially deprive resources from elsewhere? And so those are some of the factors that go into it.
Yeah, but that's the merger, so it is reactive. What about on the other side, on the competition and conduct cases? How do you decide those?
So there we've been really focused on areas where we think there's the biggest harm. And so we've identified some sectors where we think there are particular pain points for people, such as healthcare. So we've been scrutinizing, it's known publicly, the pharmacy benefit managers that are these middlemen in the pharmaceutical supply chain. We have heard a lot of concern about potential rebating practices between the manufacturers and the PBMs and how they may be.
And PBMs are pharmacy benefit managers, PBMs.
That's right. So we've heard concerns about how their practices may be basically making available for Americans not the drugs that are most affordable, but the drugs that give the PBMs the highest rebate, which is oftentimes the more expensive drugs. So we have some work on healthcare there. We've also been scrutinizing these private equity roll-ups in healthcare in particular. as well as our ongoing work looking at potential monopolization across the healthcare space. So generally, healthcare is a big area of focus. We've also been focused.
And in healthcare, if I can just interrupt. So are there particular circuits that are focused on healthcare? Is that first, second, or anywhere?
It's really across the board. I mean, our private equity anesthesiology case we filed in Houston because it was focused on Texas. But I mean, we've seen consolidation across the board. And so the hospital merger cases we've brought have ranged from, you know, Utah to New Jersey to California to North Carolina. So healthcare generally is a big area of focus. We've also been looking at more generally these dominant intermediaries that we're seeing across markets, where you basically have these major players that are connecting producers and consumers. We see that most prominently in the tech space, but we see it in all sorts of other markets. And we've seen how the practices of these dominant middlemen can have an outsized effect and an outsized harm. And so we're looking at that in healthcare, in tech. We had a case against MasterCard a few years ago where we found they were basically locking out other providers in ways that was inflating costs for retailers and consumers. And then more generally, we've been focused on some of these next generation markets because we've seen, especially in tech, acting promptly is paramount to prevent some of these markets from tipping and preventing the lock-in and the moats from being extraordinarily deep and difficult to fix on the back end.
So we get, obviously we get a lot of antitrust cases in the tech industry here in the Ninth Circuit. Does that impact, I mean, if you see private actors kind of in that space, does that impact your ability or your decision-making to just let them take care of that? So given that you've got limited resources, you go and do other things, does that have an impact at all?
Definitely. I mean, the question of if we don't act, who else will, is always a question for us. But even when there are private cases, you know, we look closely at them, try to figure out, do we think this case is fully addressing what we view as the law violation, and do we think the remedies that they would get if they're successful would fully, you know, fix what we see as the core law violations and the competition problems.
I think I read you have, you're doing some investigation on surveillance pricing for personal data.
That's right.
Is that here in the Ninth Circuit?
So this is a market inquiry. It's not a lawsuit. The FTC Act provides us the ability to do these market inquiries and market studies even outside of the law enforcement context. And so we've sent out orders to 8 of these pricing middlemen. The idea being that, you know, for a long time, the ability to engage in what's known as first degree price discrimination, so to charge every single person based on their personal willingness to pay, that's long been somewhat of a thought experiment. But now we're living in a world where there's so much personal data available on every person, and more commerce is happening through these digital tools, be it through your app or your QR code, such that retailers are, in fact, able to more easily show you an individualized price without you knowing that you're paying more than your neighbor because this company has some particular information on you. And so we're scrutinizing that layer to understand, you know, how pervasive is this surveillance pricing.
Okay, back to the question cards. Given the current makeup and decisions of the Supreme Court, isn't there a substantial risk of the FTC being significantly hamstrung by forcing now big new rules, i.e. the non-compete rule that you mentioned before?
There's no doubt there's a lot of risks for a whole set of administrative agencies right now, and we take all of that into account. We think we're acting firmly and squarely within our legal authority, and you know, the decision we got in the Eastern District of Pennsylvania yesterday was a really great vindication of that. More generally, you know, a lot of the rulemaking that we're doing is bread and butter stuff, and so we finalized this impersonator rule that addresses imposters of the government and businesses. We've also proposed a rule that would require companies make it as easy to cancel a subscription as it is to sign up for one based on a long enforcement record. Some of the rules that we've pursued are pursuant to specific statutory edicts from Congress. And so one of the first rules we finalized was our Made in USA rule, which basically says that you can't say a product is made in America if it's made somewhere else. So a lot of this is bread and butter fraud. One reason we are doing more rulemaking is because before I arrived at the FTC, the agency suffered a setback in the Supreme Court, the AMG decision, which basically said the main statutory provision of the FTC Act that the agency has used to get equitable monetary relief, that equitable monetary relief was not in fact available under that. And so overnight, you know, millions of dollars in redress that we would have been able to secure disappeared. So one reason we are doing more rulemaking is because rule violations do trigger redress and civil penalties in ways that just lawsuits now no longer do. And we think that to be an effective law enforcer, you need to make sure that the lawbreaker can't profit from the lawbreaking and has to you know, provide that redress back. And so that's one of the motivators of the expansion in rulemaking.
So follow on question with respect to the non-competes. How much more challenging, though, will it be for companies to protect their trade secrets and other confidential information under the non-compete rules?
It's an important question, and one of the key questions that we asked when we proposed this rule as an NPRM last January. And we got a lot of feedback and information, and we specifically asked how might alternative methods like, you know, trade secrets law, non-disclosure agreements be able to more appropriately protect some of these trade secrets rather than a non-compete, which is both overbroad but also under-inclusive. Because, you know, you can share trade secrets even if you're not switching jobs, and the breadth of the non-compete of preventing somebody from exiting to a rival is pretty significant. The other interesting interesting feature of this is that we've not been acting on a blank slate. States have actually been quite active. So California has, you know, for over a century.
California, yes, but I think there are only four states that have non-compete laws, right? California, Minnesota, Oklahoma, North Dakota.
Those are the ones that have near bans, but actually a whole set of other states, I think at least another dozen, have in the last decade introduced more restrictions. And so some of them have banned non-competes just with some subset of workers, be it low-wage workers or healthcare workers. But that has basically created a natural experiment that has allowed economists to isolate what are the effects of non-competes and create a whole body of research showing that these are pretty bad for competition. And so that's the backdrop against, you know, which we've taken this action. The other thing on the trade secret point, I mean, California has rendered non-competes non-enforceable for over a century, and I think we'd be hard-pressed to say that that has really come at the expense of innovation
in
California.
No, but you can, if you're at a very high level, employee, right? You can contract around that law, and they do all the time, right? Because trade secrets, especially in, you know, in the tech industry, are critically important. And you know, sometimes we get these patent cases, and I say when I do patent cases, one of the first things I try to figure out is this a divorce? Because frequently, what we see is that someone leaves a company, goes and opens up their own, but they were, you know, CFO or CTO or something like that. And there was just a human falling out. And the next thing we know, we've got a patent case because someone's stealing secrets and creating their own company. So it's a real concern. Obviously not if you're working at McDonald's, but at the high level, you spend tons of, you know, a company can spend a lot of money on capital trying to build something, and then the next thing they know, someone leaves and takes their secrets with them.
It's a really good set of questions, and ones we were especially focused on as we were doing our review of the comments that came in. So we got 26,000 comments. A lot of them were from the business community, a lot of them were from the tech community. And there's actually a lot of support in the tech community itself for the limits on non-competes and a recognition that sometimes this kind of diffusion of information is actually pretty critical to the huge innovation gains that we've seen. The rule also is structured in a way that's tiered. And so for senior executives, existing non-competes can stay in place, in part because more often than not, these non-competes are actually bargained for, and so we think there's some consideration. But it's for non-senior execs that the non-competes that are already in place would be avoided.
Another non-compete question, clearly a topic of interest for this group. The FTC is taking steps on non-competes. Are you looking at other types of contracts that many businesses use to discourage claims and or divide all consumers, like class waivers, preconditions with respect to arbitration, the common term that gives businesses the unilateral right to amend their contracts? Are you looking at other kinds of contracts that, you know, are impacting the non-compete issue?
So the non-compete rule itself prohibits non-competes and functional non-competes. And so we've heard concerns about these training repayment assistant programs where, you know, companies will say, well, I've invested in your training, and so if you're going to exit, you have to pay me back. Sometimes it's a reasonable amount, but sometimes it's, you know, 10x or 50x the amount that was actually invested. And so if we think those provisions are functioning as non-competes, they would be covered. This broader array of contractual provisions we have not been focused on, and they did not feature prominently in the comments. We, in our consumer protection work, do look at, you know, is there unfairness or is there deception? And so instances where we think some of those issues are implicated, this could come up.
So you said there were three levels. What were the other two? High level, I thought you said your non-competes kind of address three different levels of employees.
It was two levels, okay. So senior execs and non-senior executives.
Okay. For many years, the antitrust law seems to focus on what was best or is best for consumers. Is that no longer the case?
What's good for consumers is still a core part of the inquiry. I mean, the antitrust laws themselves talk about, you know, restraints of trade, talk about substantially lessening competition, talk about unfair methods of competition. We view our mandate as protecting fair competition, and you know, there are all sorts of market participants that benefit from that, consumers, you know, businesses, workers, and so we've been looking at all sides of the market, and so consumers continue to be a key part of our analysis, but we think it's also important to be looking upstream. And so we've been focused on, you know, farmers, for example, and we brought a case against these pesticide manufacturers for engaging in what we allege are these unlawful pay-to-block schemes where generic producers of pesticides are being locked out of the market in ways that is harming them but also harming farmers. We've also brought a merger challenge on the grounds that it would lessen competition not only in the product market but also in the labor market and in ways that would result in depressed wages. And so we're being more fulsome in our analysis and looking at different sides of the market.
So we've talked a lot about these non-competes, talked a lot about competition law. Competition law is different from antitrust law. There are different rules. Mm-hmm. Do you find that competition law is broader? Is it now kind of the new go-to avenue for the FTC? That is, you know, is competition law where it is as opposed to antitrust law specifically?
And by competition law, you mean the kind of unfair methods of competition?
Correct.
I mean, we've been, you know, pretty prudent and sparing in how we're invoking standalone Section 5, as it's known, in instances where we think, you know, traditional Sherman Act claims or Clayton Act claims don't follow, but where we think it's appropriate to use, we do. We also have pushed back against efforts to kind of pigeonhole within antitrust or competition what we see as, you know, unrelated issues. And so, for example, we've made clear that claims around ESG are not going to be appropriate for us to credit in the context of an illegal merger and all sorts of kind of issues in that vein. Sometimes we hear from defendants, and we've been clear that, you know, those types of commitments are not relevant to the competition analysis.
When you're bringing cases, are you leveraging the state unfair competition laws in addition to the federal claims that you're bringing?
So if we partner with the states, then the states will usually include their own standalone claims, including for unfair competition.
But you're not doing it yourself when you're acting alone?
No.
Can we shift to remedies? I like to talk about remedies. Judges aren't CEOs, right? We're not in the position of running businesses. In Judge Wilkins' NCAA case, the Supreme Court made a great effort to talk about how, you know, judges need to be focused and circumspect, and we're not CEOs. So how do you think about, and I think mergers are a little bit easier because it's like merger, no merger. So let's put mergers on the side. How do you think about remedies and what you're asking judicial officers to do in conduct cases, in competition cases? And how much of that do you think about in it, you know, how far in advance do you think of that? Because I find that, and maybe not so much the FTC, but certainly private litigants, they just, you know, they want to hit for the fences. They don't really think about what the remedy, what a reasonable remedy is for a judge to enforce. How do you think about those questions?
So we think about the remedy question quite early because it can inform, you know, just even what counts we're bringing, and what counts we are or are not bringing can affect, you know, how long the investigation continues, whether we think we need to take an existing 6 months to try to run down one issue, or if we're going to forego that particular count because we think the other counts will, you know, if we're successful, be able to deliver a remedy. And so we do think about it quite early. As a general matter, you know, antitrust remedies should prevent the illegal conduct, prevent its recurrence, and fully restore competition. What that looks like in practice can be quite challenging. I do think we've seen a whole set of experiences where what are known as behavioral remedies, so basically when you're not taking structural action, but you're basically, you know, asking the companies to not act in a way that may actually align with their interests, those can be extraordinarily difficult for us to administer and monitor. There are huge information asymmetries between us and the companies, and oftentimes those types of remedies actually do make us feel like we're being put in the position of micromanaging the business and actually substituting the executive's judgment for our own, and so we think those are pretty messy. They have a history of failure, a pretty high failure rate. And so we are usually much more focused on structural remedies where they are available. I think the fully restore competition prong is often the most important, but also the hardest about what practically it looks like.
Well, and moving forward, I mean, frequently, right, this is something that that people are focused on in terms of their, of the harm, but it's also harm that may or may not continue depending on what kind of remedy you get.
That's right. And especially in, you know, tech right now where you are seeing this new frontier of AI, I think there could be an opportunity to craft remedies that are going to make sure the unlawful monopolization that governed Web 2.0 is not going to be able to extend into Web 3.0. And so that's going to require a pretty sophisticated technological understanding about kind of what are the core entry barriers. What are the core mechanisms that these companies have been using to block competition? But I think especially as some of these cases come to resolution and hopefully the remedy stage, that'll be a really interesting question for the next generation set of technologies.
So let's also touch on global, like the global overlay. There are obviously other international enforcement agencies. Do you think they're ahead of the United States? Do you think that we as judges should look to what's happening globally in terms of our own understanding of how competition is working in the marketplace, in terms of how remedies could be effective or not effective? What do you think about the global issues in that regard?
So the global scene is important, and I was fortunate to inherit an international office at the FTC that's extraordinarily active, that has really deep relationships with enforcers around the world. And this is a very active time globally. I tend to not think about it in terms of our other jurisdictions ahead or behind, because we all have, you know, different statutory schemes and have to really focus on what do our laws say. It's clear that some jurisdictions have decided that antitrust alone is not going to be sufficient, and so they've been passing regulatory schemes, the European Commission most prominently through their Digital Markets Act, which is really focused on, you know, if we're gonna have parts of the market where you have dominant players, how do you make sure those dominant players are not abusing that power rather than, say, opening up or unlocking the market? So in as much as those schemes are now going into effect, I think it'll be really interesting to see. I do think other jurisdictions' experiences with remedies can be important for us to learn from as well, both when they've succeeded as well as when they've failed. Obviously, those are all taking place against slightly different market dynamics, slightly different facts, and so we have to take some of that with a grain of salt, but it is definitely a moment of collective learning around the world on these issues.
And how do you think about the impact of the FTC's actions on companies that are competing globally, right? The way we define a market clearly impacts the outcome, but you know, our companies are, that is our, meaning companies that are based in the United States, are competing globally with legal monopolies. Sometimes companies that are country monopolies. Is what we're doing here somehow also impacting their ability to compete abroad? And isn't that bad for the United States, for consumers? How do you gauge the impact of that, of their need to compete globally with what's happening here in the United States?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's an issue that's top of mind right now, but really one that has come up many times over the decades. I mean, famously, when the Justice Department at one point wanted to sue AT&T back in the 50s, it was actually the Defense Department that tried to dissuade them on the grounds that, you know, us taking action against AT&T would raise national security questions, and later on also invoking these kind of global competition arguments as well. I think practically, you know, as a matter of law, each of these inquiries is gonna be very fact specific. Sometimes these companies are gonna be meaningfully constrained by companies that are based elsewhere, sometimes they're not. Congress has picked up on this issue of, are US companies having to compete with basically state-backed companies, and what does that mean? And so they've passed some laws that will require us to actually ask on the front end companies that are merging for them to disclose whether they're getting funding from certain types of countries. More generally though, I do think that there has been this tension between, are we going to double down on competition, or are we gonna follow what's known as the national champions model? So the idea that every country needs to protect its monopolies so they can fight it out on the global stage. And again, this is an area where we do have some experience. Top of mind for a lot of folks right now is Boeing and kind of how did we get here? One of the mergers that was approved in the late 90s was Boeing's purchase of McDonnell Douglas, the only US competitor it had in, you know, aircraft manufacturing. And one of the arguments that was made at the time was this national champions argument that we need to buy them up so we can compete globally. You know, fast forward, we're now seeing major challenges with this company, with, you know, planes falling apart in the sky, and things are now at a stage where airlines across the world are actually saying, well, we're probably gonna have to start buying aircraft from China rather than from the United States because there's such serious supply problems. And so just from even a national security prism, the idea that a merger was allowed in part based on these national security arguments and a kind of national global competitiveness front, but the incentives to really compete and keep investing so that your airplanes would not fall apart in the sky really diminished, and now we're at a stage where we could be losing out to some of these other countries, I think it serves as a cautionary tale.
You know, as district judges, we're generalists. And so over the years, I've tried to think about what are some kind of core fundamental concepts that I think are important in antitrust cases and competition cases. And we chatted this week about ChatGPT. So my little acronym for myself is CHATS: choice, accountability, transparency, and security. What would you add to that list of kind of core concepts that we want to be, you know, cognizant of as we think about these kinds of cases? So mine are choice, accountability, transparency, security.
I think those are key ones. I think another set of issues that come up, I mean, related to security is just data privacy in particular, and the intersection between competition and privacy. And, you know, sometimes these are pitted against one another as being in tension. And so the idea that if you allow more competition, that could actually come at the expense of privacy. But I think the FTC, both enforcing the antitrust laws, but also consumer protection and privacy, has seen actually instances where these could be deeply complementary. And so I would say just generally, when you hear arguments about why we need market power or monopolization for privacy or security reasons, I think really scrutinizing that and understanding when is that legitimate and when might that be a pretense. And I think in the AI context, we're seeing a new version of those arguments, especially around this idea of openness. And so open source has historically been a key catalyst of innovation, a key way to lower entry barriers, especially for startups and innovators. And there's a really robust, interesting policy discussion in the AI space right now about whether we should have open weight models to similarly make sure that there can be more competition. And some of the arguments that we're hearing, some of which are legitimate, is that openness creates a lot of risk. It, you know, opens up these models to all sorts of bad uses. And so I think we are again in the position of having to separate and distinguish between, you know, legitimate claims to close off ecosystems and when that might be more opportunism.
Well, it's getting very close to 5 o'clock, and we are the last thing between the bar and a couple different kinds of bars and this session. So I'm going to ask one last question before they cut me off. Oh my gosh, he has cut me off, but he was behind my back. So we've talked about, you know, the possibility that the administration may change. And looking back, has there been continuity across administrations on antitrust? Or does history suggest that if there is a change in administrations, can we anticipate big changes?
As a general matter, there is enormous bipartisan agreement around the importance of reinvigorating our antitrust laws. We see that, I think, most prominently in the area of technology and digital markets, but more generally, too. I mean, I think especially in healthcare, especially in areas of PBMs, I have the fortune of testifying before Congress pretty regularly, and it's really striking to hear bipartisan concern about how, you know, monopolization is hollowing out parts of rural America, and a real visceral sense that, you know, the more we consolidate and concentrate economic power, that that can come at the expense of just working families. And so, you know, I won't predict what's going to happen, but historically there has been a lot of continuity across administrations, even as areas of focus and priorities could change.
Well, I certainly have learned a bunch over the last hour. And again, I really am appreciative and thankful to you for sharing your insights with us.
Thank you so much.